Essentially, the work of the SDDF is linked to the implementation of one of WTO's trade agreements, the WTO agreement on the application of sanitary and phytosanitary measures, or the SPS agreement. And as some of you know, that agreement essentially allows WTO members, on the one hand, to protect health, food safety, animal health, plant health, by taking SPS measures, laws, regulations, and in particular those based on international standards. But on the other hand, that agreement also essentially prevents WTO members from putting in place unjustified barriers to trade. So this agreement really tries to strike a balance. And in that context, we talk not so much about facilitating trade. The program goal of the SDDF is really to help developing countries to implement those international standards that are benchmarked in the SPS agreement, and to help them to gain, maintain market access, but also to improve, I should say, their SPS situation in the countries. And that is the program goal. But of course, that program goal is implemented in a broader sort of sustainable goals, sustainable development goals view, has sustainable economic growth, poverty reduction, food security, and also environmental in protection in developing countries. Now, the SDDF dates actually back to 2004, 1 year later than the Global Donor Platform was established. And the original founding partners, as you can see on this slide, the FAO, the World Health Organization, the OIE, World Organization for Animal Health, the World Bank Group, provided the seed funding for the SDDF and is very important from a development perspective, and of course the WTO, which provides a trade rules perspective to this facility, but also hosts the SDDF secretariat. If you look at this slide, you can essentially see how the SDDF has evolved since then and sort of who is involved at the moment. So in addition to the founding partners that I just highlighted on the previous slide, there are, of course, many other international organizations that play a role in SPS capacity building. Think, for instance, about the International Trade Center, ITC, think about UNIDO, but even at a regional level, think about organizations like AICA, think about, for instance, the African Union. All these organizations participate. We have seen recently also an increased interest in the SDDF from the private sector, and we'll give some examples in that area as well. We have selected SPS experts from developing countries involved in the SDDF, and we have a wide range of donors supporting the work of the SDDF, but also providing technical expertise. And all these let's say representatives from these organizations and donors and these experts, they convene twice per year in Geneva, always on the margins of the SPS committee in the WTO to discuss SPS capacity building and projects. The donors that are currently supporting the SDDF, there are currently 13 to 14 donors there. Well, essentially, the work of the SDDF roughly can be divided into two work streams. One is that the SDDF is really a global coordination platform, a knowledge hub, a network for SPS capacity building. But the SDDF also provides seed funding for innovative cross-cutting SPS projects, and also very important project development. Sometimes there are extremely good ideas in developing countries, but what is lacking are the financial means or the technical expertise to turn those ideas into concrete projects. This is just a slide to showcase that the SDDF Trust Fund, well, essentially has generated since 2004 approximately $60 million. Of those $60 million, approximately $45 million has been spent on SDDF projects and also project preparation grants. But this slide is also to show that it doesn't stop there. Through those projects, we have generated additional resources from government and other donors, and also the private sector. This slide just aims to show you the division among the three, let's say, SPS sub-areas of food safety, animal and plant health, while the STDF is also funding a number of what we call cross-cutting SPS projects. So, for instance, projects that have both food safety and plant health components in it. The STDF essentially has a target to dedicate at least 40% of its project resources to least developed countries and other low-income countries. And from this slide, you can essentially see that the STDF is continuously meeting that target. Currently, I think the percentage stands at approximately 60% of the projects funds that we dedicate to SPS capacity building problems and projects in least developed countries.
As you've seen, the STDF projects, they focus on strengthening sanitary and phytosanitary capacity, which is often quite technical, of quite scientific in a way. But the projects do look at the impact on women and environment through the cross-cutting issues from the application stage to the project review and evaluation. So for instance, how can women, how can the poorest benefit from these SPS capacity building projects? What kinds of impacts can strengthening SPS capacity have on the environment in terms of reducing the excessive use or misuse of pesticides or helping to protect ecosystems? So looking at the cross-cutting issues is an important part of STDF projects, many STDF projects, and we try to document and to report on this as well, including through gender disaggregated indicators. Back in 2010, we started a thematic work on public-private partnerships in collaboration with the Netherlands government and the World Bank Institute. We organized an event in The Hague that presented examples of public-private partnerships to strengthen SPS capacity and promote trade across different areas, from, for instance, diagnosis and testing to SPS inspection, also SPS infrastructure, public-private dialogue. And so this work has been continuing. Many of our STDF projects are based on a PPP-type model. A possible new project that might come to the STDF, looking at how the governments and private sector can collaborate around voluntary third-party assurance schemes. Resources are limited, so how do you decide where to invest in SPS capacity building to promote market access, whether it's national government resources or donor resources? So the STDF a few years ago has developed an approach or a tool, an evidence-based approach to strengthen and improve SPS planning and decision-making processes. And it's trying to link the SPS investments or different SPS investment options to the kinds of goals or outcomes that you would like to see in terms of improved agricultural productivity, impact on vulnerable groups, impact on women, and the trade impacts, of course. So it's really a process to look at this using the available evidence and data and information that exists. What we have seen where this approach has been applied is that it facilitates public-private dialogue. It has supported an informed project design and also helped to get funding by showing the expected impacts of investing in some of the sometimes very technical or scientific SPS capacity gaps and needs. It has helped to increase the high-level awareness about why there's a need to invest in SPS capacity building and what that means for the broader development goals, and also to get greater resource efficiency. So you're really investing in areas where you can expect to see an impact in the near term. So this approach is called PIMA, and there's a lot more information on our website. There's a new project coming up that might be of interest to the Global Donor Platform and the membership. This is a project, an STDF project that has also now received co-financing from the Enhanced Integrated Framework. It has been requested by the COMESA Secretariat, and it's about making use of PIMA to prioritize SPS investment options and to mainstream those options into the Comprehensive Agriculture Development Framework for Africa, CADEF, and other broader policy frameworks linked to trade or climate change or environment. recognizing that SPS capacity building can generate results in those areas. So this project is just now getting started, and we expect that this project will also help to improve the coherence and the linkages across the agriculture and trade communities.
Another topic of recent SDF work has been looking at trade facilitation. This work in the SDF started back in 2012, 2013, but got an additional boost when WTO members approved the trade facilitation agreement in the WTO, which also entered into force early last year. And that trade facilitation agreement essentially adds additional procedural obligations for all border agencies. So the message that we have been conveying very much so is that this trade facilitation agreement is not so much about, or it's not only about customs, it's also about other border agencies, and SPS agencies are among them. To highlight some of the key findings of the work that you can see on this slide: improving transparency, streamlining documentary requirements, the need really to implement risk-based approaches also when it comes to inspections. And we're currently together with the World Bank Group, with the World Customs Organization, and also with a number of other organizations, trying to set up a series of workshops that will look at how to improve this whole issue of border agency collaboration. And the first of those workshops is likely to take place towards the end of this year. That work on trade facilitation, I guess more recently, has sort of spilled over into some work on digitalization and looking at paperless trade. So in the SPS area, many of the agricultural, food and agricultural goods use certificates. Now, these phytosanitary certificates, veterinary certificates, sanitary certificates, they are often still in paper form, but the future is going to be that this is going to be paperless trade. So we need to move towards electronic certification. So what does this mean for developing countries? We've again organized a number of seminars on this in the WTO, and we're also funding a number of concrete projects in that area. In the phyto area, we're working with FAO and the IPPC and a broad range of other organizations and industry groups to establish a globally harmonized system to exchange electronic phyto certificates. We recently funded a small project with the OIE, which is now also starting to look into this in the veterinary area. There are also other projects where we look at sort of digitalization as a solution, for instance, in Asia Pacific.
Now we're shifting to project preparation grants. And one of the project preparation grants is basically seed funding, up to $50,000 US, based on demand. That's very important for us. From countries or from regions, usually from governments, sometimes also in collaboration with private sector. And those project preparation grants are generally used to develop complete SPS capacity building projects. They can also be used to apply the capacity evaluation tools or to assess feasibility before project development begins. And we really see a value in the PPG. The next slide is just to give you an example of a PPG that was completed last year, implemented by the Royal Veterinary College. The next slide is just to tell you about a meta-evaluation that STDF recently commissioned that looks at the experiences and results across all externally evaluated STDF projects. So a subsection of all the projects that have ever been implemented and funded by the STDF. The meta-evaluation looked into specifically 22 external project evaluations and drew a number of lessons and kind of experiences and also recommendations for us that we can use to further strengthen and improve how projects are designed, developed, implemented, and also evaluated. We really see the STDF and the value added in terms of the partnership and all the organizations and partners that are involved. And we also see opportunities to capitalize and to pull more value from all the stakeholders that are involved in order to extend the results of STDF even further. And in that regard, we are really keen to promote this exchange of lessons, experiences, outreach, and so on. And the meta-evaluation also contributes in this regard. We are also keen, moving forward with the STDF, to create and to really ensure the synergies across the thematic work that we undertake, as well as with projects and PPGs. And we are doing that, and we see more opportunities to do that in the future. In the last couple of years, really more focus on the cross-cutting issues has become really important, and looking at how can STDF projects really have those benefits on women, on the environment, trying to document it, trying to monitor it better, and also to communicate that. So increasing that focus on the priority SDGs. And if you haven't looked at our latest STDF annual report, you will see that we are kind of categorizing or giving examples and stories about STDF's work in different areas and how that contributes to particular STDF or particular sustainable development goals. We also want to build more support and to build more commitment and get more resources for SPS capacity building. This is really the last slide, and it might also, you know, stimulate some questions and discussion from you.
It's just about the process to apply to STDF project. Is it like donors that are linking you with beneficiaries, or is it part of a donor's project and you will just finance this part, or is it direct application by beneficiaries?
All the information on how to apply for STDF funding is available on our website. There's an application form for project applications, there's one for PPG applications, the project preparation grants, and there's also a guidance note for applicants who are interested in applying that explains how to complete the application form and also explains a bit more about the types of support that can be requested from the STDF.